Okay, any questions or comments about this? Does she get stuck someplace?
It was amazing what I discovered about my dream, trying to answer these questions and tell more details about the places and the persons, and I find much more things than
than you expected.
Than I expected, and in first description.
That's good. What I like what you're saying. It's like, you know, Jung said it's the way of dreams to give us more than we ask, but it's also the way of dreams to give us more than we expect. That's kind of like what your experience was. And the two of you are working together?
Yes.
Woo! Let's see how powerful it is. any other comments, questions, difficulties with being able to ask these kinds of questions? They're so simple, they're like children's questions. So I don't think there's a video of Gail doing it, but whenever Gail does it, it's just, it's always like play, asking these kinds of questions. It's a sense of wonder and openness and surprise. Remember I said trauma dreams basically repeat the traumatic experience. So I had a patient who was 24 years old, and some weeks into the therapy, she said that she had been raped when she was 14 years old. I hope this isn't awful for anyone here. If it is, you can leave or just tell me to be quiet. So the story of the rape, which I asked about, what happened, she obviously wanted to just leave it there. I got raped, and I've never told my parents, I've never told anyone. And so I finally, she ended up feeling safe enough to be able to describe the experience. And it turns out that she had had dreams for those 10 years. She had dreams about this experience exactly as it occurred in waking life. That's what Freud said about traumatic dreams, that they repeat the experience. Even Bessel van der Kolk, the neuroscientist, knows this. But what happened was she was walking home when she was 14, through a parking lot going home from school, and a man grabbed her and dragged her into the woods. He had a gun and forced her to the ground and put the gun in her mouth and raped her. So she couldn't do anything. Awful story. She, of course, said more about it haltingly, but you can imagine what this is like. So she had been having a dream of this several times a year for 10 years. So, so at one point I said, she said, oh, I had that dream. I said, well, tell me about it. And she told the dream, and sure enough, it was exactly the same story, word for word, you know, the description of the leaves and the woods and all this. And I wasn't using this method. I just was trying to live through the dream with her and live through that trauma with her, which had reoccurred to her the night before she came into therapy. That particular session. And so she told us a story, and I said, yeah, this must be, you know, I sympathized with the feelings and how awful it was, and we talked about anything she knew about the man and other kinds of things related. I tried to back off from the raw impact of the trauma. You don't want to keep doing that. You don't want to re-traumatize, but to some degree, you do have to re-enter. So a couple of weeks later, she said, I have had the dream again. I said, oh, tell me. She said, well, you know what it is. You know what happened? I said, no, tell me. And this is kind of one of those things we, in a way, are cruel. And I think there's some question about how much you want to. I mean, I think exposure therapy can be helpful in some situations. Sometimes it's re-traumatizing. So you have to make a judgment about this. And part of that judgment comes from the power of your relationship. Remember that I was saying about Freud's tube. You don't even ask anybody to talk about something that is more powerful than your attachment to them and their attachment to you, so even more than interpreting something. So she described the dream, and she said, oh, and then he dragged me into the forest, and you know, she's very upset retelling the dream, and then he threw me on the ground, and he raped me. And I said, where was the gun? And she said, oh, it was in his hand on the ground. It's not in her mouth. So, wow, that's an interesting change. You've been having the same thing, and now something has changed. So eventually, you know, so then the stream came up, and I kept coming up over the next couple of years. And so eventually he drags her into the woods, but he doesn't rape her. Then he starts dragging her, starts to drag her into the woods, doesn't get all the way to the place of the rape. Finally, he doesn't in the dream. And of course, every time she's saying it, I had that dream again. But the more we did that, the more she began to realize, well, maybe it wasn't that same dream again. So then she was in the parking lot, and he was coming at her. And then the next dream was she was in the parking lot, and he was coming at her to grab her. But there was a man who was very friendly to her and saw what was going on, and she felt safe because he was there. Now, you know, Freud would say this is a transference dream. I don't make any big deal of it. I just noticed that that was going on. Again, that's the power of the relationship. I can tolerate this stuff if I've got a connection with it, somebody that really cares about me, is connected to me, understands me. So then the next dream after this guy showed up, he wasn't in the next dream. The guy was coming in the parking lot, and she saw him coming in, and she looks over, and between two cars, she sees a baseball bat. And she reaches down and gets the baseball bat. She doesn't let him see it. He comes up to grab her and take her into the woods, and she beats the hell out of him with the baseball bat. She never had the dream again. So this is a trick. So I would be really careful about doing this kind of thing, but I wanted to come back to that because it's a very important kind of dream, and there's much more consciousness about trauma, and that's one way that I have worked with traumatic dreams. But again, you have to assess whether the person has the psychological strength and whether you have a stronger attachment than whatever the emotions are in the dream. So this therapy ended after 3 years. So that kind of a trauma dream is, it's a little bit like a self-state dream, although quite different. You know, it just says the way things stand for this person. So again, I didn't do in all the repetitions of that dream, I never gave an interpretation. I just noticed the changes. Now that was, how do you feel about the fact that he didn't even get you into the woods? How do you feel about the fact that there was a guy there? I didn't say, you know, that's probably me or anything like that. And so it's really just an inquiry about what the experience is of repeating this dream and having it change over time. You're going to see, I'm going to show you the letter boss dreams, that series of 823 dreams of engineer later on. So that's a problem. So two things in terms of gathering a context, and it's now almost 4:30. So I want to just say something quickly about understanding dreams, and then I'd like to work with Angeliki or is it Angeliki?
Whatever. I can hear both.
Well, but which is it for you?
Angeliki.
Oh, sorry, it's both wrong. I love being wrong. When I start getting cocky with somebody, I think this is what's going on. I'll ask them a question so that it'll just prove me wrong. I mean, I'll say, well, did you feel this way? And they'll say, oh, are you kidding me? So I just like to always check how far off base I can be. Look at, we'll talk very quickly. So the purpose of understanding dreams is, what do you mean with a dreamer? Understand to be the dreamer's unique implications for the dreamer, him or herself. The question is not what a dream phenomena or a whole dream means to, in themselves, but what they mean from the dreamer. Let's do the next slide. Each aspect of the dream is an aspect, each phenomenon in the dream is an aspect of the dreamer's own personality or self. And that's called the subject who dreams. It's about the person who's dreaming. They are all of those figures. So that's one of the major distinctions you have to make, which way to go here. So what Gail, by the way, does is she'll invite, she'll ask a question. Does this, here you said this, does this remind you of anyone or anything or some aspect of yourself? And so you lead the answer to the question to the dreamer. And of course, they can always say, no, I don't get it at all, and then you've got more work to do. But eventually, there will be a connection with, oh my gosh, of course. But this is one of the major distinctions. Okay, here's an example. Of these two different levels of dream interpretation. So sometimes you do a method and it doesn't work at all, these associations and descriptive methods. So I was leading a personal growth group, and I'm going to call the person's name, it was Christine. And we'd gone for 13 weeks. Most of the time, she sat in the group with long blonde hair, and like this. She couldn't even see her face. So we're very near the end of the group sessions. And I said, well, let's do one of these weeks. Let's this week do some dream work. So several people did their dreams. And we finished. We had a little time left. And I said, well, does we got a little time? Anybody else want to do a dream? And work with the dream. And yeah, can I try? I'm going to imitate her as much as I can. Draw on my acting, lack of acting experience, so forgive me. So she said, yeah, I'd like to. I said, oh, fine. So what's the dream? And she said, oh, it's a dream I've had my whole life. And she's sitting like this, so just get this, you know, kind of curled up, hidden, you can't see her face really. And she said, well, I go to the beach, and I'm expecting to have a nice day. It's a beautiful day in Hampton Beach in New Hampshire. And when I get there, I, you know, find a nice place, and I make a place for myself, and all of a sudden, this, you know, it turns out to be a tidal wave is coming in. And it starts getting dark, and this big wave is coming in and rolling up, and I wake up. And I've had that dream my whole life. And, or at least as long as I can remember. And so I used the Gestalt method, by the way. Gestalt is simply Carl Jung in humanistic technique, dramatic technique. So I said, well, tell us the dream, first person, present tense. That's the first step. These are the dramatic means. That's dramatic reiteration. I call it dramatic reiteration. I'm going out to the beach. I'm just leaving my hotel and walking across the tire, and I can feel the heat on my feet and the tire and the pavement. And then it's such a beautiful day, and I'm looking forward to it. And I get down the steps, and I look for a little place over to the left where I'm all alone. By the way, no eye contact here. That's why I'm not making eye contact with you. And I'm all alone. And so I make a little place with my fanny in my back and put my radio down, turn on my favorite music, and get out a book. And I'm really looking forward to it. And now it's... getting kind of dark and stormy, the sun's gone away, and it's the ocean's getting rough, and now it's kind of the tidal wave that comes, I'm terrified when I wake up. So I said, okay, so what about trying to be the ocean? What if you're in the ocean? There are a few other steps in between. I'm trying to cut quick here. And so I said, why don't you be the ocean and see what that's how you bring first person present tense. Well, on the ocean, and I'm big, deep, powerful, and beautiful. And here comes, I can see Cheryl coming down to be in the sun, sunbathing, and I'm kind of feeling a little agitated, so I'm just building up a big wave, and I'm gonna go down and crash on her and all the other people. And I said, well, okay, that's great. Here's one of the second, that's a dramatic identification, dramatic reiteration, repeat the whole dream first person present tense, dramatic identification, repeat the dream as a phenomenon in the dream. And I said, well, you know, Cheryl, that's not terribly convincing somehow, you dream the ocean. But can you imagine being in Carnegie Hall, which is a famous hall in New York City for performance? Imagine being in Carnegie Hall. You're on the stage, you've got a huge audience, and need to convince them that you're this ocean. So can you just go through the dream again? And really, you know, let us know what it's like to be this ocean. So, goes back her hair, first time we see her face, whole time. And she said, okay. I'm the ocean, and I am huge, and I'm deep, and I'm powerful, and I'm beautiful, and I'm powerful, and I'm beautiful, and she's sobbing, and she said, I've never said that about myself. I've never said that. And we stopped right there, and this is what Pearl's always said, if you get the existential message, you don't need to go into it anymore. It's just this incredible experience, and we're all sitting there thinking, oh my God, who is this Cheryl? So the next, we had two more weeks, and the next week, now obviously this is a subject level interpretation, right? The ocean isn't part of herself. That's the right, go being sappy again. I always end with that story. The next week, we had two more weeks. Next week, people said, hey, did you have the dream again? She said, no, I didn't. And then we had one more session. And by the way, that next session, her hair is back. She's talking to people. She's engaged. She's relating, responding, saying things. I mean, we hardly had even known what her voice was like, and now here it is. And then the last week, it was getting close to the end of the session. She was being her reticent self, open and engaging other people, but not talking about herself. But toward the end of the session, people said, hey, Cheryl, did you have the dream? She said, I was waiting for you to ask. I mean, just like that. I mean, this is not Cheryl, you know, but it is Cheryl. It's the Cheryl that had been hidden. I was waiting for you to ask. And people said, well, what happened? She said, I had the dream last night. And we said, what happened? She said, I did it, and I got a sunburn. So that's a really good example of a subject level interpretation. Now, 8 years later, I got a letter from her, and she said, I just had to tell you that 15 minutes, it was only 15 minutes, changed my life. But 3 years ago, I had grown to have enough confidence to realize that I had a problem with alcohol, and I've now been sober for 3 years, and I want to tell you that. And I immediately thought, I didn't, of course, write back and say this, I just thanked her for this and was glad, and I remembered very well, just that's all. And but I immediately thought, well, there's an object level interpretation. This wonderful, peaceful feeling that one gets from alcohol and how it becomes destructive of one's whole life and one's whole world. So that's an object level interpretation. So it's one of the best examples I've had of how a dream can have other, more than one meaning, but that I would stick with the one meaning you get right away. And if there are other meanings, they'll come out in their own time. But it's a great example of the difference between an object level interpretation, which she came to second, and subject level interpretation, which she came to first. But that's really one of the critical distinctions you need to make in the interpreting grades.
Yeah.
Is
okay now, so you can...
Oh, this is okay?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow, that's great. Okay, very quickly, for understanding dreams, there are several things that you can do to focus on in terms of an understanding of the dream. I'd rather say understanding the interpretation. You'll see, once you gather associations and descriptions, you see certain thoughts recurring. And so you can pick up one of those recurring thoughts. That qualifies as a theme, as a train of thought of the dream. Another thing is salience, something that is moving. Some moment in the dream or some moment in the associations or descriptions that is particularly powerful. And it could be moving emotionally, or it could be kind of profound intellectually, a new kind of understanding of a person. But clearly, their body changes when they say this, when they talk about this. So salience, another thing to notice is change. An example of the woman with trauma is how I use just making a notice of the change in the quality and nature of the phenomenon of the progress of the dream, how it changed from one dream to another. And a third thing you can focus on is how this dream reflects a kind of whole developmental experience. Sometimes dreams are a little autobiographies. They say how things start and are developing now and where it's going. So that's another way to understand dreams. Integrating dreams is how do you then, two things, how do you pull together the various meanings of the dream into one concise, well-integrated statement, and how do you integrate what the meaning of the dream as such is with what's going on in their waking life. So that's quite a challenging aspect of the dream, but it's the last aspect of working with dreams. Some things that you might make some comments about are a dreamer's typical difficulties in living, a dreamer's typical ways of avoiding or distorting his or her own reality, a potential or impending future circumstance or situation for the dreamer. Also, one can look at the dream as a statement about the framework. Quite often people dream about a bad framework. I had a patient who dreamt about a plumber who was not billing her, and she was very angry because he wasn't billing her for his services. And actually, this was a guy in her waking life as well. But it's when she told the dream, I thought, oh, because I can't stand doing billing, and I no longer use insurance. It's just plain, you know, we pay each session. But I was always, in those days, perpetually behind in getting bills to patients. I would just let things ride and grow terrible therapeutic discipline. I would say, really undisciplined. But most of us come into this field because we have humanitarian interests, and I have many supervisees who say, "Well, you know, I really wish I could just give this time away." Well, I think this kind of exchange really keeps the relationship safe. So that's an example of a dream where I saw right away, well, next week I had a bill that I didn't talk about it. I didn't say, you know, I just got the message. You know, here these professional people don't have the, you know, the balls to submit a bill. What's wrong with it, you know? So I got the message and had a bill for her the next week. So that's very helpful to check on whether the frame is safe and strong and free. Safe, strong, and free. And then the therapeutic relationship itself. So the last aspect of integrating dreams is grasping which meanings are the most important for the dreamer and deciding the most effective way to say this to the person. It is really a challenge. Wow, look at all the stuff we've uncovered here. How can I now say what has been in the process of integrating? How can I put it in language that will speak to the dreamer and make them more open to continuing in the process, make them more inspired and committed to the process? So how to do that? That's where it's great to get good supervision. Because in this last aspect, whether it's waking life interpretation or dream life interpretation, it's good to get supervision. This is the very hardest part. But remember, whatever understanding or interpretation grows out of the analysis of a dream, it is, or at least ought to be, mutually constituted. That statement that you make of the dream, and sometimes the patient makes it for you. Wow, this is, man, in this dream, I now understand a situation that has been bugging me in this relationship, in this work, or in my own personality for years. And this is what I now see. And I've got something I can work on. So sometimes that happens. Not terribly often. It's good to, that you end up having to